Yes, Howard, how are you doing? It's Yalen.
Hey, what's up, Yalen?
Yes. We don't have digital databases that actually interconnect and provide information. The barcoding, the QR codes on our driver's license and all those things, none of those ever contain anything at all. We've never integrated any type of database for connectivity. They are just pretty, the cards comes with the capability, but the mere fact that we have never programmed them don't mean anything.
So it doesn't sync. That's something that they have to work out in their back office.
Yes, there has to be. For instance, what happens is that the QR code, and you could go online and see how to create your QR code. You could actually put a full conversation inside of a QR code. So the information is encrypted inside of the QR code or inside of the strip on your card. Just the same way how you go use your ATM card, or you go and you give it to them and they scan the card. It has a communication protocol for verifying and authenticating information. And in fact, that information within itself can be encrypted. So in case you lose your card, somebody just can't read it. So what happens is that we don't utilize this type of advanced technology in the Bahamas. And in fact, this is going to be one of our biggest crises that we're going to be facing as we try to rebuild this economy, is the fact that we pretend. We are very, very, very good at pretending that we are doing things and we're doing it right or we're doing it the right way. The problem is that since 2020, go back to 2019, every 3 months that we have existed in this COVID environment, the world has moved 2 years ahead. So literally in the 18 months we have been around, the world has moved jumped six years ahead. The problem is that we have been a decade behind in what it is that we do. And we talk about this green economy, blue economy, orange economy, digital economy, knowledge economy, aquarian economy, data economy, conceptual economy, silver economy, and all these other different things. All of them are built on top of a big B, a digital economy. And so if we are to become competitive and to revive the economy, we have to go beyond the talk and conversation concerning digitalization and digitalization and digital transformation, et cetera. Now, let me give you an example. Do you have your laptop in front of you?
No, I got my laptop.
I want people to do me a favor, right? I can't remember the name of the wall. It's a wall where you go to those. You remember when you go to the Western movies, you used to have these cities?
Mm-hmm.
And you used to, the whole town used to be nothing but cardboard cutouts?
Yeah.
Right. This is what, technically, as we know the Internet as we knew it died about 3-4 years ago. The problem is that many of us who depend on the Internet for our intellectual, so-called knowledge, is where we can have, it's called up a Potemkin village, right? And the next concept is gaslighting. But let's go back to the Potemkin village. I want you to do me a favor, and anybody sitting in front of their computer, it's easy to do it on a desktop. I want you to go to Google and search for anything you want. Search for whatever you want. Search for digitization, COVID, whatever. And if you search for the word COVID right now, you'll end up at about 3 billion. It'll tell you your 3 billion. You know how you search for those things to tell you your 3 billion results in in a certain amount, I get 2.1 billion results in 1.4 seconds. Now, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go down to the bottom of the page, and you'll see there's only 3 pages. So at best, you will have is 300 results. So it tells you that it found billions of results, right? But you can't find more than 300 results that it actually gives you. So what it means now is that you are now confined to what they feed you as far as we have this so-called knowledge base. I often talk about this data economy, and this is how the world has shifted. You know, people used to call me all the time and say to me, you know, Seattle, you record every radio show, every talk show, every newspaper for the last 20 years. So they used to call and say, well, this person said whatever. I just want you to know that the world today as we know it, 90% of what we do in the world and the decisions we make is based on information less than 2 years old. Now, what do you mean by that? So essentially, in spite of what you think the world has so-called increased with knowledge, because data has been increasing so exponentially, as soon as you have some relevant information today, all the information you used to have that used to be relevant is no longer relevant. So the question is, why do you need to provide me with 60 years of information on a particular subject when the relevance is only for 2 to 3 years? And so the problem is that I've sat home for the last 2 decades, and I've heard talk show pundits and ever who somehow believe that the information they have that they get in the foreground that is shaped by algorithms that provides the algorithms for them is the reality of what actually runs the world, and it does not.
So essentially what you're saying to me is that the information that we consume at the forefront is shaping the narrative of the conversation, leading us into one direction or the other, but not necessarily the genuine right information.
There you go, in the right direction. And so what happens is, for instance, this, I don't want to go with government, right? Like, we talk about bringing back individuals from 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, and we talk about preserving the civil service. The problem we talk about is institutional knowledge that's in the civil service or bringing back these experts is antiquated if they're more than 2 years old. And so as you move into the so-called knowledge economy, this data economy, you'd find out that these so-called information that you claim these individuals have that's so valuable, actually it has no real value, except from a historical perspective, if you could extract the value to determine how you build somebody else in a third world country or something else of that sort. But from a development standpoint, if I call you up, Howard, from which you haven't done anything in 4 years, mm-hmm. My question to you is that if all the information you have to make information decision on is only, it needs to be 2 years old, what value are you bringing me?
That's crazy.
Right. And so here's the point. For instance, I hear the government say, oh, we're going to look at what shovel ready that the FNM left on the table. Well, I would say to you, 90% of what was left on the table is irrelevant in this new dispensation because of the change in the economic models of the world and the dynamics. Even for when you, where we talk for the fact where we talk about home mortgages and financing and everything else.
Wow. But
the world has changed so dynamically.
So how do we find ourselves aligned with that? Let me tell you why. Because I was trying to figure out some information. You know, one time ago, we could actually look at the disc of a car and make a determination who the car belongs to. Now, there is a QR code on the disc now, right? But it only says, you know, the year and the month in which right. It will be expired. And as a result of that, we find ourselves in this kind of a position now that we say, okay, we're looking at all these things to say, okay, well, I guess I could be able to scan it. I scanned it. The thing don't say nothing. It don't say who card registered to. It doesn't say anything.
But this is where, again, we're just putting them on for show. So see, if you put a QR code on a car, you could put what is called multi-tiered access, meaning when the police scan it, he punches his code. In fact, you don't have to even put in his password now. We could have biometrics, and we could put his finger there, and it'll take him further down. He could pull up on a car and tell you everything about that car, every outstanding ticket, everything that's ever happened from a police standpoint. But from an ownership standpoint, even for you, where if you and I have an accident and I want to exchange information, I could just scan that right there, and it'll give me the relevant information, make, model of that car.
But that don't do nothing.
No, but it could. But
it could.
You could do this on the internet for free. That's what I'm saying to you. We've been faking for so long
Wow. That
we actually begin to believe the fake is real. It's like, you know, you repeat a lie for so long that you begin to accept it as being true.
Wow.
And so what I'm simply saying is we are in crisis, right? And the problem is that the intellectual dishonesty that we keep imposing upon ourselves is going to lead to our destruction. Because there's an expression that says, when you're not preparing, the world is. And when the world meets you, they will beat you. And so, believe it or not, right, you talk about solving the housing crisis in the Bahamas. And because the world has changed, the Bahamas is such a powerful brand, we need no money to provide housing for people in the Bahamas. We need no money for capital advancement to do many of the things we do. And these PPPs and everything. So even for the mere fact, and I hope one day, sometime in the next week or two, you and I can have a conversation, maybe even
I'd on like that.
Because to say, for instance, how we could build 50,000 houses in the Bahamas without a dime and give it to the people for free.
I'd like that.
See, because what I'm saying is the world has shifted, you know. The problem is that we are so, and it's a good thing for people to watch, go and watch the allegory of the cave, where you have people in the cave who's watching the shadows on the wall, someone like me who's went outside of the cave and saw the sunlight and knows that there's more colors than gray. So I come back into the cave and tell the people in the cave, you know the tree has multiple colors? You know what they do in the cave? They declare me a madman. They say the sun has driven me mad. And so what happens is that we have to have an honest, open conversation of where we are and where we need to be. And this facade of conversation and leadership you're having, it has to shift, not tomorrow. It has to be done today.
Thank you so much, Mansi Allen. I really do appreciate that.